Here's something the NES did that most other home consoles did not. If you look inside cartridges for the Atari 2600 or Sega Master System, Genesis, Super Nintendo, there's a few supporting components, but you'll usually see one main chip on the board. This is the read-only memory, or ROM chip, that contains all the data for the game. The other components are mostly the same from game to game, but the ROM is where everything unique about that game lives. If you look inside an NES cartridge, though, you're likely to find two ROM chips, not just one. What is this second ROM for? Most other game systems have an internal reusable RAM for their graphics processing unit to use. The game software is responsible for copying any graphics data it needs from the game ROM into that internal RAM. This is a sensible design. With all of the game data in one place, there's only one set of connections to worry about. However, Nintendo decided it would be better to connect the GPU directly to a second ROM inside the cartridge that was dedicated to just graphics data. This is fairly normal to do in arcade machines, where there's only one game and one set of graphics to worry about, but it's more unusual to see in a home console. I think Nintendo's main concern here was that rewritable RAM was a very expensive component compared to the mask ROM chips used for read-only data. This probably lowered the cost of the NES system significantly, but also meant that some of that cost was unloaded onto each cartridge, which now has to have a second set of connecting pins for a second ROM chip. If you ever wondered why Nintendo made that weird pop-down tray with the so-called zero insertion force connector, it was because they were worried all these extra pins would create too much strain on a more typical slot connection. With all of these extra pins, though, there was a lot more information directly available to the cartridge itself. It was quickly realized that the extra lines could be used for more than just addressing the graphics ROM, and later generations of NES games started putting extra devices inside the cartridge. Mostly, this was to expand the size of the ROM data, but they also found a few other ways to improve the system's capabilities, which was a big part of why the NES lasted on the market as long as it did. Its unique design gave the machine a bit of life support in the form of add-on hardware that could hide right inside the cartridge itself. Transferring some of the cost of the console into the cartridge seems to have really paid off here, and a slight increase in cartridge price was probably a lot more palatable to consumers than system upgrades, like the Genesis 32X proved to be. So, what's in these two ROMs exactly? The standard names Nintendo used for them is CHR and PRG. CHR stands for character, which refers to a history of computer graphics where text was displayed as a grid of characters. The character ROM contains a set of 4-color, 8x8 pixel tiles, which were used for text display, but also for everything else you saw. Everything was made of these tiles. PRG stood for program. The program ROM contained nearly everything else, the software code, music data, levels, even some graphical information that wasn't tiles was stored in there. It was much more generic, and all of its data was accessible to the central processing unit. The character tiles being separate has some other interesting consequences too. Because it was connected directly to the GPU, none of this graphics data could be compressed. All of it is stored in a standard format that requires no special reverse engineering. When emulators became popular, this was great for ROM hackers, and editors like YYCHR were created that made it very easy to modify and customize the graphics of NES games. On systems where RAM is used instead, the graphics data could be unpacked from the main ROM before it was copied to RAM, and there were a lot of custom techniques for compressing and storing that data that varied from game to game. In cases like that, it can be a lot more work to figure out the graphics data before you can alter it. Actually, even on the NES, about a quarter of games ended up using a RAM chip in place of the character ROM. There were a lot of advantages to being able to have custom storage methods, and also being able to reuse and rewrite that RAM while the game is running. Plus, the RAM chips themselves slowly became more affordable over the years. So there's a lot of good reasons why most other systems did it with RAM, and it's still the dominant paradigm today with modern GPUs. So when someone talks about an NES ROM, they're usually talking about a .NES file, which is actually a collection of two ROMs, the character ROM and the program ROM, with a little bit of extra data about the kind of cartridge hardware needed. There were actually a lot of different hardware configurations found inside the cartridges, which are commonly referred to as mappers in the emulation community. There's literally hundreds of different mapper types, and simulating all of these is one of the big challenges of writing an NES emulator. Here's a fun thing you can try with .NES files, though. I wrote a little Python script to take just the character ROM and progressively reduce the resolution of its tiles, kind of like a mosaic filter, making those 8x8 pixels look like 4x4, and then 2x2, and finally as if each tile was just one big pixel. I think Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles looks awfully nice at half the scale. That frog has lost a lot of detail, but I think I can still make out the plot of Blaster Master. Maybe. Mega Man 5 even looks good at a quarter size. Trevor Belmont is getting a bit blocky, though. At 1/8 here, Kirby's roundness isn't apparent at all. Maybe this is going too far. But I guess Tetris is still mostly the same game at this resolution. Do you think these graphics might get past Nintendo's Content ID system? I had this idea while I was working on my own NES game, and I actually threw it in as a little Easter egg, which I called Bad Eyesight Mode. Have any of you figured out how to do this in Lizard? In the video description, there's a link to the Python script, so you can try it out for yourself. Just place a bunch of NES ROMs in the same folder, and run the script to generate three new versions of each game with progressively degraded graphics. As I was saying though, about 25% of NES games used RAM in place of character ROM, so it won't work on everything, but it will work on the majority. I hope you have fun trying this out, and thanks for listening.